Welcome to Etherlords 2, I'm your host Lostwolfe. This is episode 67, and we're about to go to a new map, so let's do that together. I love the way that the end of a map screen is basically the same as the end of a battle screen. That's priceless. Anyway, this is chapter 4 of this particular set of missions. We have confrontation. Let's hear what the narrator has to say. We're just going to play on easy, of course. So we're just here for the story and the silly card battles. So here we go.
Determined that Diamanda is at the root of the Pale invasion, Mirabelle races against the synthet forces in order to destroy her and save the ether world.
And in we go.
This new task the Council of 16 has set for me is the only thing on my mind now. Will I be worthy of the better's choice, or am I destined to die? There are surely spells in the nearest fortress that would make me a better warrior. There I may also hear the word of the betters on my forthcoming quest.
I love the way she's doing all the fighting, but they're her betters. She's winning all the wars and whatnot, but they're like, we will tell you what to do. Anyway, so she's going to run ahead. Let's let her run ahead.
Noble Mirabelle, thanks to you, now our families are all wishing for more female children.
This is Drunken, who we met in a, well, not met in the last chapter, they mentioned in the last chapter. He is the guy that's going to guide us here. I find it odd that they're all wishing for more female children. They should just wish for children. But this is, I mean, I guess it's cool in a way because she is being a awesome woman who's kicking tail, and I guess that's cool. I do like that.
Thank you, Honorable Drunken. I came to see you at the order of the Council of 16.
You enter into a battle we cannot afford to lose, on the faraway northern peninsula, where our land meets the realm of the synthets, the Pale forces are born.
What are you talking about, Honorable Drunken? What Pale forces?
There has Diamanda found her refuge. The scholars who lifted the veil hiding the secrets connecting events gave us this insight. The one who defeats Diamanda will conquer the plague forever.
I like how also we've stepped from one map into another. And she's confused by how the Pale are still around. But surely she should have seen that anyway.
I understand. I'm ready to fulfill this prophecy.
Okay, and just like another game, let's just loose. Let's grab this. We can talk to Drunken if we like.
I'm relying on your wisdom, Honorable Drunken. What should I know about the road to the target?
Hasten to the jetty. You shall reach Diamanda's domain only if you enter the teleporter established eons ago on the Northern Isle. Many a hero has died trying to find the road. Only one returned and to his brethren spoke. Remember, O warrior who reaches the Central Island. Much can there be found to strengthen you beyond all telling.
My gratitude knows no limits, Honorable Drunken.
And that's about all we're going to get out of him. Anyway, so there's this thing over here that we can look at. Ooh.
Greetings, warrior of synthesis. We've just received ether maps from the scientists. The most powerful ether funnel is in the northern peninsula at the Kinet's border. Looks like the secret to this pale rust is hidden there. That's also where the scouts have spotted Diamanda. The scientists believe she's the driving force behind the whole invasion. The pale creatures obey her. If we can defeat her, we'll be able to destroy this pale rust plague completely.
So here we see that it seems like the synthets want the same thing we do.
Or make it serve the synthesis. We've won this war, so that would be our right.
Or not. Anyway, so it zips back to here. And now we can just wander around freely. There's a store here. And of the things that are in the store, the only thing that interests me is this. So let's take a look at everything just so that we see what we see. We have power balance, which costs 4 ether. If the caster's opponent has a greater number of ether channels, the caster gains 3 ether channels. So what this means is if they have even one more than you do, you can sort of skip ahead. I guess that's ramp for blue, this color that we're playing right now. Ramp is not such an issue. Getting to giant creatures is. Anyway, we also have stasis. Stasis acts and behaves almost like the Magic the Gathering card stasis. It costs 2 ether, down to its casting cost. It's an enchantment too. Heroes do not gain ether by any means while stasis is active. So this immediately cuts off the ether that people can get. That doesn't mean they can't gain ether channels, just that they can't gain ether. The controller of this enchantment must pay ether at the beginning of each turn, or remove stasis from play. The cost for maintaining stasis, and like down to, there were effects that made stasis worse in Magic the Gathering. This one's just built right in. The cost for maintaining stasis in play is 2 ether on the first turn, and then increases by 2 each following turn. So by the time you get to turn 3, for example, it costs 6 because it's 2 by 2 by 2. And then we have over here, change of command. This costs 5 ether, it's very expensive, but what it does is the controller of this enchantment gains control of the enchanted creature until the creature is destroyed, or until change of command is removed. So either one of two things happens. When you destroy it, obviously goes into the original owner's graveyard. Change of command gets destroyed, then the guy goes back to the original owner's side of the table. We want change of command in particular. The rest is fairly iffy to me. I am neither here nor there about that. Okay, so there's a couple of bits and bobs here that we can pick up. There, and I want to say, oh, I think that's it, actually. Oh well, let's hop aboard this magic ship that they were talking about. There. Okay, and now we're loaded on the ship. Now it seems like there's directions you can go here, but the only direction that matters for us right now is up and down this sort of peninsula. So if we go up this way, we will spot that there's a beacon, which increases speed. We've seen those before. But also, if we go over here, we will see extra bits that we can pick up. For example, there, and then over here, we have our first guy that we're going to battle in this campaign. He's a rock wall. The hero has a chance to negate any melee damage received in combat, and he's got stuff that we want. So we're going to change our deck for a minute. This is, as you'll recall, our deck from the last go-around. We need to take some stuff out here. Hunger isn't going to work. He's a wall, so he makes naught X creatures. So hunger obviously makes no sense. Hunger goes out. And we're going to take a curse. Oh, we're going to take the only curse and the only malison. Okay. We're going to put in. We're going to move these guys this way. I want another one. Where am I unsummoned? Unsummons, where are you? Realistically, I should be selling some of this, but like I panic about doing that because I never know when any of this is going to be useful. And we're going to see a change of command in action. So the problem with this particular deck is, his deck, is that one of the walls can bump its power up. And he can, in fact, bump the power of every wall that he has through some of his cards. and that becomes problematic. Let's attack. An easiest way to deal with that is simply to remove the wall out of the combat area. This is pretty good. Okay, so here we have Nord 10. Walls can attack. This is just a generic old rock wall. I'm gonna make a alarm here. This particular wall is a problem, but it's not the biggest problem. Okay, so what did he do? You can't see it back there. But there is a Shadow Wolf. It's a 4-3, it costs 5 ether, it has first strike. It can be blocked only by walls. So there's no point in taking control of this, right? What will happen is that he will end up with it. He will end up being able to block it. So we're just going to put that... Well, let's put this back into his hand. And then we'll attack. Ow. That is gonna hurt. So what did he do there? He wins a flame. Pegs ether, deal X damage to all creatures with flying ability. We didn't have any creatures with flying ability, so it didn't hurt us. And then he did this strength. Plus 2 ether. Power of the enchanted creature increases by 4. So this went from a 4-3 to a 12-3. Owie. Anyway, it's fine. He won't be casting anything else, which is the main thing. Now, part of me wants to steal his wolf. Part of me, we'll steal his wolf. It's a bit of a fool's errand because he has disenchants and that kind of thing. But a 12-3 isn't something to sneeze at. And it will knock out most of his walls, so there is that, like this little 10 here. Now, I'm going to play with fire a little. I'm going to put the wall in his hand. Oh, good. Okay, my specialization went off, which means he potentially lost a card. We don't know what he lost, but that's okay. Sure. He's making an Ort 7. He's making an Ort 11. This particular wall over here, the Nort 11, is the big problem. Okay, so what happened here, and if you're wondering why this is Nort 11 when it says Nort 10 here, it's because of this guy. This is the silicon wall. It is 2 ether. Walls cannot attack. Toughness of all friendly walls increased by 1. So what I'm inclined to do here is I'm just inclined to steal this. And the reason why I'm inclined to steal this is because I can attack at wall here. Hopefully knock 2 cards out of his hand when he doesn't block these 2. Because I'm sure he's going to block the 12-3. And then profit. Maybe. You know what? Let's actually steal his other wall too. Now it's important to note that when I stole this, it stayed in Ort 11. So this fixes the power and toughness the minute things come into play. If he summons anything on his side now, because it says of all friendly walls, it means that my line, if I summoned any more walls, would get bigger, but his will not. But this is going to stick around for as long as this guy is not unsummoned or something. It's weird. I don't know why it works this way. Hopefully we knock some cards out of his hand. Yep. Yep. Oh, okay. The red means that his specialization is going off. Ew. He negated a whole pile of my damage. It's okay. I think we're just going to keep playing my very dangerous game. We'll just grab all of his stuff. Oh, okay, well, his own wolf killed him. That's a good outcome. Grab that. And now we're just gonna go along the coast. There's a jetty over here that I don't want to get involved in quite yet. Because there's a couple other things that we can see along here. There's a bee queen here. That's really difficult to see. She's against the node. I guess if I turn the camera there. Okay. Every turn in combat, there is a chance that a creature from the graveyard will return to the hero's hand. Which is pretty annoying, but we're not actually going to see that in action very much, so it's fine. We need to alter our deck again, though. So, the way the Bee Queen works is the Bee Queen makes a million little 1/1s and 2/2s and all that sort of stuff. There's no point in keeping the change of command in because the change of command is too slow. And also, because generally we're going to want to trade and we won't want unequal trades. And from that perspective, it makes sense to not keep these in. We want to take out. An unsummon, a Lamia monk, and a Lamia warlord. So, okay, there's a lot of space here. What are we going to do with the space? The first thing that we're going to do is we're going to put in some air elementals. Air elementals are great because they're restless and unblockable, but they also create unfair trades because it's a 3/6. So, most of his stuff is flying, but when it comes to combat, it can't block. So, it's good for us, right? So, we want three of these. Actually, let me just get this over here. We want three of these. We want two Ravaging Hunger, and the reason why we want Ravaging Hunger as opposed to regular hunger is because it kills the board. So the idea is to set up lopsided hungers that go off and kill his side of the board but don't kill yours because these are 3/6s. I only want two of them though. And we want two Water Elementals. And again, Water Elemental is lopsided, 6/6/7. Oops, I did not mean for that to happen. And we should be good now. Now, for several turns here, I'm not going to do very much. And when I do things, I'm going to put lopsided things out, like the Water Elemental. But it may be that at the beginning here, I take a lot of damage. Okay, so a couple of things happened in those turns. The first thing that happened was he made a bee worker. And now you'll see that that's a 0/1, but how is it bigger? Well, the bee queen here is making it larger, but let's get through this first. We've seen this before. Flying power, all bees increases by 1, so he's giving additional power to himself. Bee worker dies after dealing any amount of damage to the enemy hero. He also has over here this guy. Oh, he has a pair of bee workers. Alright, that's fine. I am okay with that. This is going to fall off the edge of the card slots, but that's okay. It's going to fall off the edge of my hand. I do not. Okay. Okay, so here's the reason why we want to nuke the board. This is Mother Bee. Mother Bee seems totally harmless. It cannot attack and it's flying. Yay, it has regeneration too. We're going to try and catch it when it can't regenerate. All bees gain first strike. That's fine. All bees gain berserk, which means that they must attack every turn until after their controller's next attack phase. When Mother Bee dies, rest, pay to either spawn bee warrior. This is the problem. She can just make an endless font of bees, and that is kind of bad. Now the problem is his specialization may kick in, and that is a worrying thing. Ah, there we go. Icky poo. This is pretty bad because I'm not set up to actually do another Ravaging Hunger. Oh well. Let's start making guys. I'm leading with Alamia predominantly because if I can get through for damage, there's a chance. And you can see he's got a lot of cards in his hand, that I can start getting cards out of his hand. Okay, that's gonna die. He's just gaining ether here and spawning dudes. Oh god. Well, this is not going well at all. Ow. Let's do this. Part of me would like to actually put the Mother Bee, one Mother Bee, back into his hand. Because that way he can't produce quite so many worker bees. This isn't great though. Ow. What's he doing? In case you're wondering, he's doing Twister. Destroy target creature, deal X damage to the caster, where X is the power of the destroyed creature. So he is actually hurting himself every time he does that. I think we should do this. Half of the reason why I'm doing this way is because I am kind of hoping to run into another, oh goodness. What happened there? Destroy target creature's flying ability, he killed his own guy, and then, this is funny, I've never seen the computer misplay quite like this. He killed his own guy, and then regeneration saved him. That's hilarious. Okay, let's put this back into your hand so that you can't spawn bee warriors. And I think I'd like the ability to be able to draw a card. And we're just going to attack. There's no point in not attacking. This doesn't have flying, so can't really block. Nope, something came back from the dead. I guess we put a worker bee back into his hand. Because this at least makes the other bees not quite as strong. And I do want to draw. Oh, interesting. This is 8. This is 1. I think we're going to do this. And we are going to Maybe what we should do is see if there's another... Let's just click over there. There is another worker bee. Okay. Let's slow this bleed down a little bit. Slow the bleeding down a little bit. And attack with just the one guy. And he did it again. That would almost be amazing if it weren't so silly. Ow. Okay, I am searching for a ravaging hunger. Nope, no such luck. So, I think we make this and this. And part of my thinking here, and we're going to start keeping the Lamia monk back. Part of my thinking here is that we're digging for ravaging hunger so we can wipe the board. And once we wipe the board, we can just repopulate. Okay, hit, take a card away. Okay, good. I'm not sure what happened there. Everything glowed. Oh, he didn't like me drawing extra cards. Boo to that. Okay, we're going to take a lot of damage here because none of my guys flies. Okay, I want to get the ability to draw a card back, so let's do that. And I guess we'll just put it out. And there's no point in not attacking, as we've discovered. Yay! He dropped a card. Okay, something came back from the dead. I guess he has an enchantment going. No, he doesn't. Weird. Ow. Ow. Oh, good. Okay, so now... Part of the problem that I have with etherlords, right? And it's a big problem. Is that I can't do... attack first and then spells, because it makes more sense to me right now to attack, get the attack in, do the spells afterwards. But I have to do if I'm gonna draw, I need to do it now and see what we get. Oh, we get nothing useful. All right, let's I guess we ravaging hunger. We won't kill the mother bee. That's a problem. We want ravaging hunger, sure. Okay, let's make this then. Let's go fetch you and put you down. And I think we make a 6-7. Yeah, we make a 6-7, sure. Because that way we can start actually getting in for some damage. Take a card. Good. Yep. Yep, we're gonna take damage. Let's look at what's in our graveyard. I guess we take... Can I really take the air elemental? I shouldn't be able to. Yeah, it's returning Lamia. That's not really a Lamia friend. We're gonna make the Lamia. We're gonna make this. Again, that's a 6-7. And then I think we'll just run in and attack. I'm not going to draw a card. There's no point in drawing a card. Oh, well, okay, he just rolled over and died. Sure. I'm okay with that outcome. Okay, so we get thirsty creatures. What it's trying to slowly do is, as you can see from this, it's trying to nudge me towards non-creature decks. The problem is that on easy, there's no good way of making non-creature decks because everyone just has the one deck or the one set of draws. So thirsty creatures cost 3 ether. At the beginning of his turn, each hero must pay 1 ether for each friendly creature in play. We gain some experience. And we're going to grab this because that's what we came here for. The last guy that we're going to fight for today is along the coast over here. Maybe a little tricky to see. Oh, there we go. The Wall of Wind, 90, level 9. That's a crazy amount of life, by the way. Specialization to enhanced water link. Every time the water link spell passes health to the hero, there's a chance that the actual health passed will be equal to the sum of the creature's power and toughness, rather than equal to the creature's toughness only. So, let's talk about that for a minute. If you have, for example, an 8-7, normally it would just give him 7 life, but now there's a chance that it will give him 15 because it'll be 8 plus the 7. We're going to change this deck completely because it doesn't work for what he's doing. So because it's making walls again, we need to get rid of the hunger, right? So Ravaging Hunger goes immediately. We're going to take the water elementals. They're gonna go. We're gonna take the air elementals. They're also gonna go. And this deck is probably gonna wind up looking a little familiar. Because we're just gonna do what we've been doing all along. We're gonna line it up. We want a Lamia Warlord. Which is up this way. Tell me, Warlord, where are you? Uh-oh. I have misplaced my Lamia Warlord. There she is. Okay. We need one Lamia Monk. We're not going to take the complement of 3, but we do need 2 of them. We're going to take one extra unsummon. Where you unsummon? There. Hiding away. I wish this did this in some kind of order, but it doesn't anyways. That, like, this is a change of command. Realistically, I'd want that at the top because it's C, but oh well. And I want... Oh, we want our friends. Where they curse? Well, this is Malison, but yeah, no. Chris and Madison. We need two of each. All right. The idea here with this particular deck is that it's going to make a wall that's very, very frustrating. Because again, the wall gets bigger. And I want to get rid of the wall the second I see it. So we're going to try and put it back into its hand. We're going to do our trick of putting it back into its hand with Unsummon and then ditching it with hopefully Curse. Now, initially, upon looking at this, you think 90 health. Oh, God, that's pretty scary. But the reason, half of the reason we're running the full complement of Lamias is so that we can ditch cards out of his hand and eventually just win through sheer attrition. We've now won. It's just a question of attrition. Okay, good. Let's start getting 8/7s so we can start making things cheaper. And now, hopefully, anytime he has cards, we will start ditching them out of his hand. Because we will use our specialization, like it happened there, to get them out of his hand. I'm not even going to worry about going to get extra cards at this point. Because while I do think that he probably has Ravaging Hunger, hopefully we can set it up so that we go multiple times and knock it out of his hand. There we go. Because the more Lamia we have out on the table, the more chances we have of getting our specialization to work. And attack. Ta-da. That took a long time, but it was mostly just a battle of attrition. And there you have it. That is episode 67 all wrapped up. It gave us Waterlink. We didn't see that in the last battle. We just saw that it had a description of sort of what Waterlink did. But this is Waterlink. So it's an enchantment. It costs 1. If the enchanted creature goes to the graveyard, so it can be on your side or their side, because you can enchant your own guys, of course. It will return to play under the command of the owner of this enchantment. So you are the owner, you're the guy casting it. It will come into play under your side. So what that means is you can start stealing his guys. There's no enchantment on them anymore, so it becomes very difficult for them to get their guy back. And he only gains an amount of life equal to the enchanted creature's toughness when he goes to the graveyard. So the person who owned the creature gains it. It's life and toughness. This is pretty good, and I like Waterlink a lot. A-Link, this is silly. Creature gains life type ability. It's okay, but I don't like that it's bolting this onto an enchantment, because as we've seen, enchantments can get discarded. Or disenchanted, I should say. Oh, right, it's going to level me up here. We get luck, basic, slightly better chance for hero specialization to work. Meh. We have a concentration. He receives 1 additional spell every second turn in combat. We already have concentration, so I'm most likely to take this. and we have sufficient basic. Slightly worse chance for enemy specialization to work. It's slightly less. Slightly worse chance. So, shrug. So we're going to take the concentration. More cards is good. The more cards we have, the more options we have. And that's it. Thank you so much for watching. I've been your host, Lostwolfe. This has been episode 67 of my friend etherlords 2. I hope that you're enjoying it as much as I'm enjoying playing it for you. I'm going to grab this. Then I'm going to go. You have a wonderful evening. And good night for now.